Hi, hello, welcome to Unacademy Foundation classes. Yes, we are in 9th live daily. So today we'll be talking about diversity in living organism. So lecture 10. But before starting the classes, please download Telegram app. So if you want to connect me or if you have got doubts regarding any of the topics in the biology, you can connect me by downloading Telegram app and typing this URL. So that is tinyurl.com/unacademyfoundation. So you have to type this URL in the browser so that you'll be able to connect, you'll be able to join to a group, and then you can ask me questions in the group as well as personally as well. And one more important thing, yes, about Unacademy learning app. So if you want to get access to different courses, so I know a lot of exams are going to come up in the month of November. So NSCJS, NTSC, NSO as well, right? So if you want to get access to different interesting capsule courses of different competitive exams, you can download learning app, Unacademy learning app. So once you install Unacademy learning app, you are able to see a screen. So then go for plus option. So when you click on plus option, you are able to see a screen. So again, click on foundation and NTSC. So when you click on foundation and NTSC, go for get subscription. Okay, so you can see different month subscription, 1 month, 3 month, 6 month, 12 month, 24 month subscription. So you can take any month subscription here. So, but if you see 12 month subscription, you will be able to get 58% offer. And again, if you use Foundation Live code, okay, again, you're going to get 10% offer. So totally you have to pay 15,750 rupees per year. Okay, so this is for a year, not for a month. Okay, so 15,750 rupees is really cost effective, because if you're going to coaching centers or a tuition centers, so you have to travel. So travel expenses separate and tuition classes fees are separate. But here, if you see 15,750, you're paying for a year only for the classes, because you no need of traveling anywhere. You can sit at your home or any place you want and listen to the classes, talk to the educators, interact with the educators. You can solve more and more quiz questions, because we have separate quiz sessions, weekly, monthly quiz as well. Okay, so take the subscription as soon as possible. Fine. So let's quickly start the class. But before to that, what you have to do, my dear students, please like the video, subscribe to our channel and share the video. And also you are able to actually, you're able to download the PDF notes as well, right? Yes. So this is actually a last lecture on diversity in living organisms. Yes, we are going to talk about animals and birds today. Yes. So before to that, let's see classification once again, because you need to know which organism, which phyla belongs to which category, right? So we were in vertebrates. So we have discussed about the vertebrates, again, agnatha and gnathostomata. What is agnatha without jaws? Gnathostomata with jaws. So example also we have seen under agnatha in the previous classes, cyclostomata is one of the example. Right, and gnathostomata with jaws. Okay, again it is divided into pisces and tetrapoda. Okay, so pisces are again divided into placodermi, chondractis and osteactis. Okay, osteictis and chondractis. Okay, so placodermi, most of the organisms under placodermi, it has gone extinct. Fine. And coming to tetrapoda, we have talked about pisces in the previous classes, right? So tetrapoda again divided into amphibia. We have spoken about amphibia, reptilia as well, reptiles, right? And then today we are going to talk about apes, that is birds, right? A beautiful organisms which can fly, right? So everybody want to fly like birds, right? So we'll be going to talk about birds today. Yes, and mammalia as well. So we belong to mammalia, class mammalia, mammals, right? Yes, you can see monkeys and birds flying here. So today we are going to talk about this. So starting from the class apes, let's quickly see the important features of these class apes, that is about birds. So what are the different things that you can remember if you see a bird? Do they have limbs? Do they have hands? No. So four limbs are modified to wings. So what is the difference between four limbs and hind limbs? Four limbs. fore limbs is present at the anterior position, whereas hind limb is present at the posterior position. So hind limbs are modified into wings, right? Yes. So they are warm-blooded with fore limbs are modified into wings. So what are these warm-blooded? We have seen cold-blooded in the previous classes. Okay. Warm-blooded animals, they are able to regulate their body temperature. Okay. They are able to regulate their internal body temperature. Okay. Depending on the weather conditions. Okay. So we have constant stable body temperature. We belong to warm-blooded animals. Fine. The hind limbs are adapted for walking, perching, swimming, and they have scales, epidermal scales on their legs, right? So even in the reptiles, we have seen scales, right? Whereas here hind limbs will have what? Hind limbs are important for walking, perching, swimming, okay? Jumping as well. Certain birds, they are not able to walk. They will jump and walk, right? So coming to other features, the upper and lower jaws are modified into beak without teeth. Yes. So this again we can make out. So these are important features, and even if you remember one bird, you're able to see all these characteristic features, right? So coming to other features, they have spongy elastic lungs, okay, for respiration. So how do they respire? Of course, by lungs. So these are closely related to mammals, as well as if you see the features, some of the important features, they look like they have got similarities towards reptiles, right? So just before this class, we have seen reptiles. So now apes. So coming to other features, the voice is produced in a special organ called as syrinx. Very important, syrinx. So they sing a song, they make different sounds, but there are certain birds who can mimic us, who can mimic other organisms, right? So how do they do this? How do they produce voice? They produce voice by a specialized organ called as syrinx, okay? Yes. So this is a bird you can see which can fly. So here you can see the forelimb is modified into wings, right? And if you see the beaks, so upper and lower jaws are modified into beaks, right? So very beautiful organism. I just love birds. I had habit of collecting feathers of different, you know, birds in my, I can say when I was a student, when I was a primary school student, I had a habit of collecting the feathers especially, right? So coming to the other features about the heart. So even these are, even birds are able to show four chambered heart. So hence double circulation. Remember single circulation, we have seen in one type of class, which is that single circulation, fishes, right? How many chambers of heart? Two chambers of heart. So we have seen in the previous classes. And it has got 12 pairs of cranial nerves. Even we do have 12 pairs of cranial nerves. And endoskeleton is bony. They have endoskeleton. They have got skeleton system. Yes. So now there is a doubt. Even these skeleton, you know about importance of skeleton. So we feel heavy because of the skeleton system, right? We are strong because of the skeleton system. But how come this organism, in spite of having the skeleton system, in spite of having the bones, they are able to fly in air? So reason is here. The endoskeleton, the endoskeleton is bony with long hollow bones filled with air cavities. So they have got bones. But the bones are filled with the air cavities and it is hollow, right? So they have a single ovary and oviduct on the left side. Whereas we have got pair of ovaries, right? So if you see the bone, it is hollow. So because of this, they are able to fly. They are able to feel the lightness, Okay. So all the birds are oviparous. So what is this oviparous? The organisms which can, you know, lay eggs. Okay. Viviparous, the organisms which are able to give rise to young ones. Fine. So we are able to see sexual dimorphism. In the sense, you can make out which is female and which is male bird. So coming to peacock, right? So in peacock, you are able to make out which is female and which is male. And very interesting thing about these organisms, aves, is females are less attractive than males. So males are the one which is more attractive than the females under class aves. So what is the main reason behind this? So usually for the, especially for the mating purpose, okay? So it has, these birds, they are able to show certain, you know, response called as courtship for the mating, okay? So I hope you know what is mating between male and female organism or male and female birds. So in order to mate, so the males have to attract the females. So this is the main reason. Males are more attractive than females. Okay? Yes. So the eggs have 4 embryonic membranes. So what are these embryonic membranes? So this is quite advanced and higher for you about, you know, embryonic membranes. So allantoin, chorion, yes, amnion and yolk sac. So these are the 4 embryonic membranes. So these embryonic membranes are important for the development of embryo. Okay? Yes. So they have spindle shaped body. So in which organism we have seen spindle shaped body before? Fishes. Right? What was the importance of this spindle shaped body? To move against water current in the case of fishes. But here, spindle shaped body, it minimizes the resistance to the wind. Whereas in the case of fishes, we have seen it reduces the resistance to water current. Here it is wind, right? So spindle shaped body we can see under class aves. Okay, so they have feathers that allow the air to pass and reduce the friction to a minimum, because they have to reduce the resistance because they are traveling against the wind, right? So these are the important features of aves. So these are the examples for birds. So sparrow, peacock, crow, dove and pigeon, turkey, parrot, raven, eagle, hawk, goose. So there are many, many, many more examples for birds. Colorful birds, different, colored feathered birds. And again, it is depending on, you know, different temperature, weather condition. You can see different type of birds, right? So again, some of the birds we use for commercial purpose, for the production of eggs, for the production of meat, right? And we know about importance of pigeon, right? So in the early days, our ancestors or our forefathers, they were using this pigeon to send the messages. But now we won't be seeing in the, you know, this is a time of cell phone and smartphone, okay? Yes. So, the next class is about mammalia, mammals. So, we belong to mammalia. So, we are going to understand about ourselves. So, these are the characteristic features. Again, we are warm-blooded. So, you know what is the meaning of warm-blooded organisms, right? And very important feature is about we have got why? Why the class mammalia called as mammalia? Because of the presence of mammary glands that help them to produce milk to feed the young ones. So this is the main reason the class mammalia has got the name mammalia, right? So their skin possesses oil glands, okay, and sweat glands. Whereas in the case of birds, even though there is a oil glands, there is no presence of hairs or I can say skin. Okay, instead of feathers are present. So here the oil glands and sweat glands we are able to see. Okay, sudoriferous glands or sebaceous gland. Very important. So coming to the fur of hair throughout the body, which helps animals to adapt to their environment. So from mammalia, we are not able to see the scales, whereas in reptilia and apes, we could see the presence of scales. Okay, so it was important for the protection. Whereas in the case of mammalia, what is exactly present for the protection? Hairs, furs, body hairs, right? Facial body hairs for the protection. So they are heterodont. So what is this heterodont? Heterodont is presence of different type of teeth. Okay. So what are the different types of teeth we have got? Canines, incisors, molars, premolars, right? So we have got different type of teeth, and especially if you see human beings, again, we have to, you know, we can differentiate the teeth depending on the, we have got permanent and milk teeth. What is milk teeth? Milk teeth is nothing but the teeth that we have got right from our, not right from our birth, but after the birth, there will be development of teeth, right? So that teeth is called as milk teeth. Okay. So later, after a certain age, these all milk teeth will fall off, and then there will be permanent teeth. So even if you lose milk teeth, so it is able to produce the body, or I can say the jaws are able to produce teeth again if you lose milk teeth. But if you lose permanent teeth, there won't be reoccurring of these teeth again, right? Yes. So trunk is divided into thorax and abdomen, and we respire through, of course, we know, lungs, right? Yes. So going to the other features, mammals have four chambered heart, hence double circulation, and again 12 pairs of cranial nerves. So we know about double circulation, and sinus, venous and renal portal system are absent. Of course, we belong to double circulation. So double circulation, I can say closed circulation we have got. So blood vessels are present to carry the blood, to show up the circulation, right? So brain is well developed with the cerebrum, cerebellum and medulla. Okay. And yes, 12 pairs of cranial nerves. So where exactly these cranial nerves are present? It is present inside spinal cord. Right? So how exactly spinal cord is produced in our body? It is actually produced from the nerve cord, which is a very, very important feature, a key feature of chordata. Yes? Okay. So exhibit one of the most advanced forms of diaphragm. So what is this diaphragm? So in the respiration, we use this diaphragm. In the sense, there will be inflation, or I can say expansion and relaxation of this diaphragm. So we have got diaphragm, which is well advanced, and mammals can lay eggs also sometimes. Which is that mammal which is able to lay eggs? Comment below. Okay, and most of us are viviparous. Okay, there is a small correction. So the mammals, actually here it should be cannot lay eggs, but sometimes there is a few examples whereas certain mammals are able to lay eggs. Okay, so usually the mammals which is able to give rise to young ones are called as viviparous. Okay, yes. So these are the features. So you know the examples which belongs to mammals. What are the examples which actually belongs to mammals? Human beings, deer, cow. So you know, it's very, very easy to remember examples for mammals, right? Yes, even here you can see certain gif, and of course monkeys, right? So these all belong to class mammals. Now we are going to summarize whatever we have studied in the previous classes. It's very important to remember all of the kingdoms and all key features of each and every kingdom, okay? Because you have to remember these features for the exam. Okay, yes. So coming to all five kingdoms, okay, which is most accepted. Yes, I will be explaining you each and everything. So first kingdom, Monera. So prokaryotes or Monera. So under prokaryotes, again, there are of two types, archaea and eubacteria. Okay? Yes. So cell types are prokaryotes. What is prokaryotes? You know, primitive nucleus. Nucleoid is present in prokaryotes. Yes. And coming to protista. So from protista, all are eukaryote. Protista, fungi, plantae, animalia, these all are eukaryotes. Coming to the cell wall. So cell wall of prokaryotes, they have got cell wall. Okay. If you see archaebacteria, they have got pseudopeptidoglycan in the cell wall. Whereas eubacteria, if you consider, they have got peptidoglycan in their cell wall. Okay. So protista. So in some, a few of the organisms under protista, they have got cell wall, but most of the organisms under protista, they do not have cell wall. And fungi. Fungi also have got cell wall, but here we are not able to see cellulose. Instead of cellulose, chitin is present. Chitin, mucin and mannoprotein is present under fungi cell wall. Coming to plantae, yes, hemicellulose, cellulose, pectin, these are present in the cell wall. But animals, you know, we do not have got cell wall. Instead of that, we have got what? Like other organisms, we have got cell membrane or plasma membrane. About nuclear membrane. So just now we have seen about the cell type that we are, you know, prokaryotes. So of course, what is prokaryotes? Primitive nucleus. So here the nuclear region is does not has got membrane. So no nuclear membrane, only in the case of Monera. So all other organisms, we have got nuclear membrane. Coming to body organization. What is the meaning of body organization? How the body is made up of? Okay. So all are cellular. So protista and Monera. Okay. These are unicellular. But coming to fungi, from fungi to animalia, we all are multicellular, but some of the organisms under fungi has got tissues, okay, loose tissues. Whereas plantae, some of them have got tissue and organ. But if you see animalia, we have got tissue, organ system. Okay. So coming to mode of nutrition. So prokaryotes have got both autotrophic and heterotrophic nutrition. Okay. Some of the bacteria, they are able to show photosynthesis as well. And some of the archaebacteria, they are chemoautotrophs as well. Okay. So both, and yes, of course, some of the bacteria, they are heterotrophs. Some of them are parasites. And these bacteria are cosmopolitan, right? So they are autotrophic and heterotrophic. And coming to protista. Protista are, most of them are heterotrophic. But some are autotrophic, right? And fungi. Fungi are purely heterotrophic. So most of them are saprophytic and some of them are parasitic, right? So which are those organisms which are saprophytic? Agaricus. Which of them which are, parasitic? Puccinia. So there are certain, plant fungal diseases, okay? As well as animal fungal diseases as well. So these are able to show parasitic mode of nutrition. So coming to kingdom plantae, all are autotrophic. Okay. All are autotrophic. Again, they are photosynthetic. Fine. Animalia. Again, all are heterotrophic. So some of them are saprophytic, holozoic, parasitic, right? Yes. So these are the classification of all the five kingdoms. So again, we have classified kingdom plantae. So we have seen each and every divisions, superclasses, classes. So we'll be summarizing whatever we have studied in the previous classes here. Okay. So kingdom plantae is divided into different types. So do not have differentiated plant body, that is thallophyta. Okay. But one which has got differentiated plant body is again divided into vascular and non-vascular plants. So what is this thallophyta? So plant body is thallus. So it does not has got true roots, stem and leaves. Okay, so example is algae. So Cara or Spirogyra. Okay, so these are some of the examples. So one the plants which has got differentiated plant body. What are these? These just now have told you it is divided into vascular and non-vascular. Okay, so vascular again divided into phanerogams and cryptogams. Okay, so one which does not has got vascular tissue is called as they are bryophytes. So what are the important features of bryophyte? Amphibian of plant kingdom, correct? So the body of bryophyte are divided into, they have got root like stem like leaves like parts. So roots can be called as rhizoids here. Okay, so which plant body is dominant? Gametophyte is dominant under bryophyta. Okay, so coming to vascular tissue. So example for bryophyta, you know, moss, right? So vascular tissue is divided into, I mean, the organisms, the plants which has got vascular tissue is divided into one which bears or produce seeds and one which does not produce seeds. So these are called as cryptogams, right? Okay, so example is pteridophyte. So what is the important feature of pteridophyte? So here sporophytic plant body is dominant and as well as it is independent to the gametophytic plant body. Okay, so examples are ferns, pteris. Why the name pteridophyta? Because of feather like leaves. Okay, so here you are able to see the vascular tissue. So it is the first organisms, first I can say category to get vascular tissue, and also these are considered as terrestrial plants, right? So these are the first plants to come to the land. Coming to phanerogams. What is the meaning of phanerogams? One which is able to produce seeds. Seeds is exposed, right? So bear fruits and one which does not bear fruits. So this is how we are able to classify phanerogams into gymnosperms and angiosperms. Gymnosperms is naked seeds, one which does not contain fruit. So fruit is not covered to the seeds, right? So gymnosperm, pinus, cycas. So these are the examples, right? So coming to phanerogams, one which bear seeds and fruits, correct? So angiosperms. So here you are able to see endosperm development, embryo and endosperm. What is this endosperm? A reserve food, right? For the growing embryo. And as well as we are able to see the flowers, flower bearing, fruit bearing plants. So again, angiosperms can be divided into monocot and dicot. Monocot, which means one cotyledons. Dicot means two cotyledons. So we have seen the different features of monocot and dicot in detail in the previous classes. So let me not talk about monocot and dicot in detail. I have talked about these in detail in the previous class, right? So this is about kingdom plantae. Okay, so what are the different things that you have to remember here? Thallophyta, bryophyta, pteridophyta, gymnosperm and angiosperm. So coming to kingdom, yes, animalia. So kingdom animalia can be divided into actually vertebrates and invertebrates. So under invertebrates, you are able to see cellular level organization and tissue level organization. So cellular level organization means it has got cellular aggregate rather than tissue. Okay, so each cells have got specialized functions. So example, poriferans. So phylum Porifera belongs to cellular level organization. Okay, so coming to tissue level of organization. So starting from Cylindrata, Platyhelminthes, Aschelminthes, and again coelomate. So we'll be talking about this once again now. Okay, so tissue level of organization. So again divided into body cavities. So depending on the different body cavities, we are able to differentiate tissue level of organization containing organisms. Okay, so Cylindrata and Platyhelminthes, which are acoelomate, which means there is no true body cavity. So I have told you what is exactly true body cavity means. Okay, so there are two cavities if you see in the organization. One is digestive and one more is a true body cavity. So the true body cavity is the one which has got mesodermal linings. Okay, it is lined by the mesodermal layer. Okay, we have seen in the previous class about acoelomate, pseudocoelomate and eucoelomate. Okay, so cylindrata and platyhelminthes, they belong to acoelomate. So no body cavity between epidermis and gastrodermis. Okay, so what does this mean, epidermis, gastrodermis? So these are nothing but, I can say, it is does not has got mesodermal lining. Coming to pseudocoelome, so which has got body cavity, I mean it has got digestive cavity as well as a body cavity, but it is not true because it is not completely lined by mesodermal layer. It is lined by endodermal and mesodermal layer, but it is not completely lined by mesodermal layer on the both the sides. Okay, so pseudocoelome is nematoda or Aschelminthes. Okay, so coming to coelomata. So again, to remember all of this phylum, I have given you a mnemonics. I hope you remember, right? So coming to coelomata, which means true body cavity. So which are the one which has got true body cavity? Yes, even we belong here. So we belong to enterocoelom actually. So coelomata also we can divide into two. So mesodermal cells from a single cell during growth of the embryo. So eucoelomata are nothing but annelida, mollusca, arthropoda. So they have got both digestive cavity and the true coelom, true body cavity. So mesodermal cells from a single cell during growth of the embryo. So it is lined by mesodermal layer. Okay, these type of organisms. But coelom formed from the pouches pinched off from the endodermal layer. So this cavity is formed from endodermal layer. Okay, but it is lined by mesodermal cells only. Fine. So again, we are able to differentiate this type of organisms depending on the presence of notochord and absence of notochord. Yes. So absence of notochord is echinodermata, enterocoelom. Right? We are enterocoelom, but we have got notochord. But echinodermata does not has got notochord. Okay? So chordata again divided into different types, protochordata and vertebrata. So what are these protochordata? These are primitive chordata because notochord is present in at least larval forms, but very rudimentary. But if you see chordata, notochord is replaced by vertebral column in the adults. So it is present in an embryonic stage. Okay, but here in the case of protochordata, we have seen where exactly notochord can be present. So we have divided based on the presence of the notochord in the different stages. Urochordata, right? Cephalochordata, we have seen in the previous classes. So I hope there is no need of explaining once again. Fine. So coming to vertebrata once again. So this we have seen all of these classes. Yes, today we were talking about aphids and mammalia. So very first is Pisces, exoskeleton of scales, endoskeleton of bones and cartilages, breathing through gills. So cartilaginous and bony fishes we have seen. Okay. So this is the one which does not has got foot. Okay. So exoskeleton has got different type of scales, ctenoid, cycloid, placoid. Okay, yes. So coming to the next class, that is amphibia. So gills are present just like Pisces, but only in the larval stage, and it has got slimy skin as well as lungs. And then coming to reptilia. Reptilia are the terrestrial organisms, exoskeleton of scales, and we are able to see ecdysis or molting or shedding of their skin under reptilia, and they lay eggs. they lay eggs outside the water. Coming to apes. So today we have talked in detail about apes. Exoskeleton have got feathers instead of scales. And they lay eggs outside the water, and flight is possible by using feathers and have got hollow endoskeleton. Coming to us, mammalia. Exoskeleton bears hairs. Not feathers, not scales, but we have got hairs or furs, right? And mostly giving birth to living young ones, okay? So this is about the classification. I hope this class was helpful for you. So what you have to do now, please like the video, subscribe to our channel, and never miss to share the video and download the PDF if you have got requirement of the notes. And yes, click on bell icon so that you won't be missing any of the videos. Okay, so thank you so much. So in the next class, we'll be discussing about the questions. Okay, so until then, keep watching all the videos and like all the videos.